So I have almost finished laying out the PEX. I figured before I wrapped up everything, I'd give you a quick sort of overview of what I've done here, or at least what I've tried to do. So for a bit of background, the green stuff that you're seeing is what I laid out in the last video. That's 3-inch thick insulating foam. It's the EPS foam, that's like the white polystyrene that you're used to seeing, sort of around packaging and all that sort of stuff. It's green because it's covered with a vapor barrier, so water can't come through from the dirt or gravel underneath into the concrete slab that's going to be poured on top of all of this. But the main purpose of that foam is to insulate the ground from these pipes, because these pipes are what's going to be providing the heat source for this entire building. In addition to putting the 3-inch foam at the bottom, I have 3 inches of the XPS foam around the outside. That gives me an R value of R15 on the outside, R10 underneath the slab, which should be plenty to insulate the slab from the earth. So this is a radiant hydronic heating system. Hydronic because there's going to be water flowing through these pipes, or really a mix of water and antifreeze, ethylene glycol. Where should I start? This is all one zone. What that means is that there's going to be a single pump and a single electric water heater heating up the water that flows into these pipes. All of these lines here terminate under here. We'll go under there in a second at a manifold where they'll be connected to a 27 kilowatt electric water heater, which will produce hopefully 120 degrees Fahrenheit water at a rate of around 7 gallons a minute. So it's all going to be one zone, which means that it'll either all be on or all be off, or we can't have differential temperatures because we only have one water heater. But even though it's one zone, there are multiple circuits. Now, a circuit is a loop, a 300-foot loop of PEX. I'm using 300-foot long, half-inch diameter PEX lines. And you can see, I don't know if you can see there, it's kind of hard to trace these because they're all the same color. But I have 1, 2, 3 circuits at the back here that all come down and through to the manifold. The idea of having that end there sort of separated from the main space is that although it's on one zone, each circuit has its own ball valve, and I can limit down the flow to that end region there because I can keep that as a cold side if I don't want to sort of be using heat over there too much. In terms of spacing, the most of the spacing is 1 foot on center between each pipe. But around the edges, I don't know if you can really see the difference here, I've got 9 inches instead of 12 inches on those three lines out there. Also, there's 9 inches spacing all the way around the outside. The idea there is that heat will be escaping through the insulation on the side, and so we want to pump a little bit more heat into the sides there. Also, the space that I'm standing on top of here, under here is the office. We'll go down and look at that, or maybe I can go under like that. Most of the office is also 9 inches on center, the idea being there that I want to keep the office a little bit warmer. So we have 12-inch spacing in the center, 9-inch spacing on the sides. We have a separate 3 circuits down there for the garage space in case I want to keep that cold. One thing I should mention about this green stuff is it's called Crete Heat, and there's a few products like it, but this is the first one I found. It had good reviews, and instead of just being regular polystyrene boards, it has these knobs on it, and that makes it really easy to lay out the lines. I was really worried about how long it would take and how difficult it would be to lay out all of this PEX. The last big project that I worked with PEX was laying out a few hundred feet of irrigation, and that was in the middle of summer when it was warm and hopefully the pipe was flexible. But it was really difficult to do. We have an intruder. Hey, puppy. You can't see me up here. There you go. So that 1-inch line that I had to do over summer was really difficult to do, but it was 1 inch. And I was worried that this 1/2-inch stuff would be just as difficult, But the reality was that it was pretty easy. It took about half an hour to run a circuit of 300 foot in length. But the reality was that I'd lay it down and I'd look at it and go, huh, I can get the spacing better, or I can fix this up a little bit more so that I'm not leaving as much hanging out at the end of the line, like unused, like I wanted to use as much pipe as possible. So I'd spend half an hour, I'd lay it out for the first time, then I'd rip it up and lay it back down again. And the second time would take 15 minutes. So probably each circuit here has been laid down once at half an hour and then moved twice again at 15 minutes each. So each circuit probably took an hour to do. There are 12 circuits here, so it's been about 12 hours of moving a pipe around. Now, I did try and plan the circuit layout beforehand so I wouldn't have to do a lot of moving, but the plans that I got from the company weren't great. So I worked with a company called Radiant Tech. I chose them because they have really fantastic educational materials online. I really liked that they made all that stuff free and available, so I was really happy to work with them. Now, I do have a service where they'll do a full design for you. I opted not to pay for that service. So they gave me a couple of sort of example layouts that would work in this space. Those circuits that they gave me weren't perfect because they used more than 300 foot per circuit, and I only had 300 foot lines, and I didn't want to have any run longer than 300 foot. And the other circuit example that they gave me used less than 300 foot per run, but didn't give me that separation of the garage space down there. So I decided to draw my own plans, which I did using Google Sheets, because why use a drawing program when you can abuse a spreadsheet? That worked out pretty well. But when I went to actually lay out the pipes, the printer was out of cerulean ink or something and refused to print my black and white diagram, which was a pain in the ass. So I couldn't print it out. So I figured I'd just look at it on my phone, and I didn't quite get it right. And so I was very quickly freestyling. And given that it was pretty easy to lay down and rip up, I didn't mind. If anyone's ever done any circuit board layout, it's a very similar therapeutic meditative activity. But there's a big difference between sort of PCB layout and laying this stuff out is on, you know, PCB routing. It's just a few mouse clicks and keyboard movements to move something over. Whereas here it's a lot of bending, lifting, carrying, and it's a little bit slower. But it's still the same part of the brain. There's still some sort of zen-like satisfaction that comes from laying it out. I'm pretty happy with how the layout looks. I was trying to optimize for too many things in the layout that I was doing on my computer, one of which was making sure everything lined up at the manifold. I'll go downstairs and show you how I didn't quite succeed at getting everything to line up down there. So let's go down and have a look. So here we are at the manifold, and you can see it's a bit of a mess. When I did my layout, I forgot that these manifolds were laid out like this. So I'll come in closer and show you where the confusion was. So this is a manifold here with six supply lines and six return lines. They're currently connected together and they have a pressure valve on there. And the reason for that is once I've got everything connected, I can pressurize this and make sure that there are no leaks. In fact, the county requires me to do a test where I pressurize it to 100 PSI, they inspect, and then hopefully will approve. But I thought the manifolds were laid out with the supply there and the return above it or just behind it, and so that you could have the supply and return lines running parallel to each other. But as it is here, supply line goes out here, then comes back and goes in to the return over here. I was trying to work out how to lay this out so that my lines didn't cross over each other. I did not succeed, as you can see. So my next task here is to clean all of this up. Thank you. So I have half of it connected to the manifold. There's six circuits, six more to go. It's a little neater down here. I'm going to do some more tidying up once everything's sort of in its place. I think now would be a good time to do a pressure test. Bit of a moment of truth here. Does this thing hold air? And then if it holds air, it will hold water. So there's a pressure gauge, Schrader valve, I think is under here. I hope that's a Schrader valve. All right, we are at 50 PSI. I'm gonna hold this here for an hour, get some lunch, and see if it holds up. Just came back from a big walk with the dog, had a big lunch. It's been a couple of hours. We are still at 50 PSI. That is good. I'm gonna finish doing the rest of this manifold, test that and leave it pressurized overnight. And hopefully it all holds.